Hi, my name is Patrick. Basically, I am a CAT 100 percentile 5 times, scored rank 1 in ZAT, rank 1 in CET many times. The idea of this video is to help you and tell you how to prepare for mathematics as far as the CAT exam is concerned. This same rule will apply for the other exams as well. So if you're looking at CET exam or the banking exam or any other exam, the same rules basically will apply. But yes, since I've been training students on CAT many years, so I'll focus on CAT and take a few questions on CAT and tell you how to approach the questions. Okay, now let's start with looking at what is the syllabus for CAT. So basically, CAT syllabus is school mathematics. So if you look at what comes in the examination, is nothing more than school mathematics. So what you need to prepare is school level and which you already studied before, so there should be nothing difficult about it. But there's a problem with that, and the problem with that is when people prepare for the exam, they prepare like they prepared in school. So how did you all prepare mathematics in school? Now in school we had marks for every step that you write. You write a formula, you write an equation, you get a mark. Every step you had a mark. So people are habituated to write in every step. And that is a problem. Also, if you look at all the books that are available, the notes for various classes also teach you in a similar manner. So they will give you a question and they will have a formula or an equation and they will have steps to solve. Unfortunately, this is not the right method. And this is the very reason why people don't perform well in CAT. Okay, it's a faulty way of preparation because CAT doesn't look at the way you prepare in school, the mathematics. The way you prepare for CAT is completely different or the other entrance exam. CAT questions can normally and easily be solved without formulas and equations. It can easily be solved. Learning formulas or using equations normally make it tough. Why does it make it tough? I mean, normally people say that if I learn more formulas, I should be able to do well in CAT. But that is not the case. What happens is that when you learn too much of too many formulae, it is cluttered in your mind and you don't know which formula to apply where. You learn a formula, you go to an exam and you try to apply the formula. But unfortunately, most of the questions that come in the exam are not based on a formula. And therefore, you find it difficult. So you realize that in the books, you were able to solve all the sums because the books were based on formulas. Okay, but in the exam, you're not able to solve. Because the exam, the questions are not based on formulae. Okay, and same with equations. So therefore, people find it a little difficult to solve. You can use equations, some of the sum, but that takes a longer time than not using equations. So which means that the way we prepare for the exam is wrong. And that is the reason most of the students find it difficult to crack the examination. Because the method of preparation is wrong. So normally the CAT questions are not normally tough. I mean, if you go outside the exam and try to solve it, it is comparatively easy to solve. I have put solutions for all CAT 17 paper and maybe even CAT 18 paper for all the maths questions. And you will realize it's not at all difficult to solve. As a matter of fact, in the examination, both CAT 17 and CAT 18, I was able to solve all the questions. Did silly mistakes in one or two questions, but not that I couldn't solve it. I could solve all the questions. So that's where it is important that you use different methods. So let's try to understand by taking a couple of questions that have come in CAT 18. How to approach and how to solve. So here the question is, a trader sells 10 liters of mixtures of paint A and B, where the amount of B in the mixture does not exceed that of A. So B is less than A. The cost of paint A per liter is rupees 8 more than that of paint B. If a trader sells the entire mixture for 264 and makes a profit of 10%, then the highest possible cost of paint B in rupees per liter is. So if you try to form an equation or formula, let me tell you, it is going to take a long time. As a matter, it becomes difficult because they have not given you the exact proportion of A and B. So your whole solving of this sum has to go on the basis of your understanding of the concepts. If you don't understand the concept, it will become very difficult to solve. So let's look at how to solve. I mean, I look at the direct approach. So if you look at it, you can directly find the cost price from the selling price. The one normal way of calculation is the reverse method. So reverse method is you go from the end to the start. The end is the profit that you get or the selling price. From there we will go to the quantity. So we are going to the end to the start. So you can put this formula, or you can clearly make out that 264 ending in 4. You can assume cost price is 240, profit is 24, you will get 264 straight away. So you can make out that the cost price is 240. You should be good at assuming things. If you're good at assuming things, you can be a little bit faster. If you can't do this, then obviously you can do cost price equal to selling price upon 1 plus profit percent. I'm not normally for putting these formulas, etc. I'm usually for putting values because that becomes faster. Anyway, either way, you get a cost price of 240. Now this 240 is for 10 liters. So per liter, the price is 24. Also, you can make out that the value or cost of B will be high when the quantity of B will be the highest. And the quantity of B will be highest when A and B are equally mixed. Okay, quantity of B will be maximum when A and B will be equally mixed, because they said that amount of B does not exceed that of A. So more the weightage of B, the closer it is to the average. So A and B are equal and B is less than the average, automatically you can make out that B will be less than 24. 24 minus 4, because difference between A and B is 8, so, and average will be in between. So difference between average and B will be 4. So you can make out the value of B will be 24 minus 4, which will be 20 straight away. Technically, it doesn't take much time. The moment you see 264, you can make out the cost price is 240. Cost price is 240, per liter you get 24. And then you minus 4, you get 20 straight away. If you get the understand the sum, the solution doesn't take time. The key is to understand the sum. I'll tell you how to build your approach to, you know, get this sum. So when you go to the further slides, I will try to get you into how to approach these questions, how to build your approaches. But let's take one more question. When they work alone, B needs 25% more time to finish the job than A does. The two finish the job in 13 days in the following manner. A works alone till half the job is done. Then A and B together for 4 days. And finally, B works alone to complete the remaining 5% of the work. How many days can B alone? So this looks tough, but if you actually see, you can easily get the answer. Look, all the values are integers. So you have total 13 days. When A completes half the job, ideally that should also be integer. Ideally, I'm just putting an assumption that ideally that should also be integer. Half the job will complete in integer days. Right? And then A and B will work for 4 days. So automatically the last 5% also job that is completed by B should be integer. The last 5% job that is completed by B should be an integer number of days. So if 5% is completed in 1 day, then total number of days taken by B to complete the work will be, straight away you get 20, you can straight away mark the answer as 20. Without calculating, without. If you understand this sum, you can make out that if 5% takes 1 day, then 100% will take 20 days. None of the other things will give you the answer. I mean, 5% you can't have in 1.5 days or 5% can't have in 0.5 days because you'll not get the options as the answer. Right? But I'll confirm. I mean, I'm not saying that I'll mark directly. I normally get the answer first, but I should confirm whether it is there, the answer. Okay? So as I said, 5% should be in 1 day. It can't be 2 days. It can't be 4 days because you'll not get the answer. So 5% in 1 day, so 100% in 20 days. So I know 20 is the answer. So let's confirm if that is the answer or not. So if B takes 20 days, then A will take 16 days. Remember, B takes 25% more time than A. So you can directly make out that if A is 16, 25% more will be plus 4, which will give you 20. Right? You should be good at this. If you're not, then you can obviously do 20 upon 1.25, which will give you 16. But I'm normally for assuming numbers and getting the answer faster. A alone will then take 8 days to complete half the work. Remember, half the work is completed by A first. And then they will work together for 4 days, so 12 days. And last one day B will work, 13 days is what I want. So we get 13 days. So 13 days is what is there. We get the answer. So it did not take me much time to solve this. Okay, I can directly make out 5% 20 days, substitute and get the answer. But how do you build up this in the exam? What people do normally when you get this sum in the exam? The first thing that they'll do is start assuming that number of days taken by BBX. Then you will get that number of days taken by AB 0.8x. And then they start putting an equation and then they solve it. A question which can be solved within a minute, they will end up taking 4-5 minutes just to understand and try to put an equation and solve. And putting an equation to these sums are not very simple. It will just take more time. Okay. So I normally tell people to build approaches, because approaches will not only make you fast but also makes you accurate. That's what I've seen with the students. And the moment you're fast, you can obviously solve more questions. Right? I'm not saying you can get the approach for all the sums that may come. I normally can solve in the exam because I'm used to it. But even if you get it for a few sums, I think it can make a huge difference in your scores in the exam. So students, normally what happens, it doesn't click these methods because they don't learn these methods at all. And the problem, one more thing is, any new method that you learn takes a longer time to grasp and be fast. For example, when you want to learn to cycle, what happens? You start cycling, you fall, you get hurt. Initially you'll be very slow. But once you get a hang of it, anyone can learn it. And the same with these methods. Once you get a hang of it, I'm sure you'll be able to learn it. It's only that the initial phase will be a little tough, where you have to give a try, you have to push yourself, where you may be frustrated not getting a sum. But once you start learning, believe me, you'll be really, really fast. Okay, the reason I am right now scoring 100% is purely because of methods, and I've seen my students doing really well. So how do you learn these methods? Okay, so normally what I say is, before you start solving any sum with traditional methods, try solving the sum without equation formulae. So that means you have a sum in front of you. Think for 2 minutes at least as to how can you solve this without, you know, equations. Start with simple sums. And start with very simple sums and start solving without equation formulae. Once you get a hang of it, then maybe you can take slightly tougher sums if you want. Okay. But it is important that you push yourself. And I said that initially it could be tough. This is also true for speed-based exam. I can score rank 1 in even CD exam, which is a speed-based exam, purely because my speed in mathematics. I can solve things really fast. And that is not because I am good at math or something like that, but it's purely because my methods are good. And the methods makes a big difference with regards to the way you solve the exam. So does this method work? Yes, I've been teaching for more than 15 years and I've seen people even with 40% or less scoring a 99% in mathematics in the examination. In the exam, these sums need not be implemented in all sums. Now look, ideally I can solve almost all the sums in the exam with this, but even if you can solve few sums with these methods, I think it can make, you can give you a good percentile. So it is very important, only if you practice and start getting used to it will you be able to use. Try this and I'm sure you'll be able to. Technically, as I said, almost all the 34 questions can be solved without equation formulae. I've done that. I've put it on CAT 17. I put it in a YouTube group. You can check it out. But you will learn only if you get used to it. People, look, when you see other people cycling and you don't know cycling, you feel, oh, they're very good at it. It's because they've learned it. It's very simple as that. Same with methods. The moment you learn it, you'll automatically become fast. Okay. So these methods not only helps you become fast, but also helps you to become accurate. So I will load a few more videos in terms of how to prepare, what to prepare, etc. You can subscribe to the video. I will take few more sums and tell you how methods will be solved for the CAT exam. And I'm sure that will help you as such. Right? Thank you. See you in the next video.